It was at 2:45 a.m. on August 10th, 1985 that the contracts were signed, and Michael Jackson was now the new owner of the prestigious ATV music catalog after 10 months of intense, confusing, on-again and off-again negotiations. The package included the publishing rights of over 4,000 songs, including hits by Little Richard, the Pointer Sisters, and the Pretenders. But the jewel in its crown was undeniably the near full catalog of Beatles music, spanning from 1964 to the group's breakup in 1970. At 26, Jackson was already one of the most successful performers in pop music and was now also among the top 15 music publishers in the world. For an agreed price of $47.5 million, the acquisition stands as the most expensive publishing purchase ever undertaken by an individual, outbidding several other companies, including London-based Virgin Records and, ironically, MPL Communications, which was owned by Paul McCartney. Surprising fans and many powerful music executives, this bold business move shifted Michael Jackson's public image from a once teeny bopper turned Peter Pan of pop to an out-and-out music mogul. Jackson, who was already credited for reviving the music industry with the unprecedented sales of Thriller, was now determined to wield his newfound fortune and considerable commercial influence in the pursuit of a level of power and unimaginable wealth never achieved by any artist before him. This is the story of that relentless pursuit that didn't go without its conflicts, walkouts, and attacks directed at Jackson that would forever impact him as an artist, as well as the dynamics of his own personal relationships. Having signed with Motown in 1969, Michael Jackson and his brothers were exposed to the inner workings of the music industry at a very young age. Michael's father, Joe Jackson, was heavily involved in all aspects of business for the group and was fully aware of the often harsh realities of the music industry, as well as its history of cheating black artists out of the recognition and financial compensation they deserve. The most glaringly obvious example of this was the popularization of rock and roll music throughout the 1950s, with its immediate roots in the African-American jazz, gospel, country, and rhythm and blues music of the 1940s. The new genre was unashamedly rebranded for a white audience. Rock and roll classics of this period were very often covered songs originally written and performed by black artists, which were then popularized by their white counterparts with the backing of large record labels, raking in countless hits and creating a whitewashed legacy that music executives continue to profiteer from till this day. One example of this is when Little Richard, one of the original founders of rock and roll, recorded and released his groundbreaking hit, Tutti Frutti, in 1955. The song was soon covered by Pat Boone, who took it down multiple notches, making it safer for the consumption of white teenagers, and the single became a much bigger hit than the original. Like many performers, Little Richard was then largely cheated out of his music publishing and copyrights, which devastated the artist and impacted him both financially and emotionally. Richard would later attempt to sue his former record label in 1984 for $112 million, claiming he was not paid any royalties for his music after leaving the label. Michael Jackson, who was greatly influenced by the likes of James Brown, Little Richard, and Jackie Wilson, not only studied them musically and in their performance style, but also learned from their mistakes in business. As James Brown put it, black recording artists were all too often welcomed in the show, but not in the show business. After the unprecedented success of his off-the-wall record and while negotiating percentages for his next LP, Jackson's personal attorney, John Branca, managed to secure approximately $2 for each album sold, the highest royalty rate in the music industry up until that point. So, when Thriller became the best-selling album of 1983 and 1984, the first album to do so, which at one point was selling more than 1 million copies a week, the arrangement significantly boosted Michael Jackson's own personal wealth. And by 1985, Jackson had reportedly earned more than $50 million from music royalties alone. With royalty checks piling in, Jackson instructed Branca to find suitable investments for his newfound fortune. Pursuing music publishing was an obvious choice, and a keen interest for Michael after spending time with Paul McCartney, who himself had built an impressive portfolio of publishing rights. Michael Jackson only wanted songs that meant a lot to him, so he declined to bid on all but three of the 40 catalogs presented to him over this period. Eventually, Michael bought the Sly Stone collection, which includes pop soul gems as Everyday People and Everybody Is a Star. He also purchased the Double Diamond package that features Lynn Berry's 1-2-3 and the Soul Survivors' Expressway to Your Heart. By the beginning of 1984, Jackson was engulfed setting up the Jackson's Victory Tour, and the matter of catalogs had faded into the background until a September meeting with John Branca in Philadelphia. "By the way, the ATV catalog is available," said Branca. "Yeah, Mike, the Beatles." Jackson did a full turn, jumped in the air and shrieked, "I want it, please." The negotiations. John Branca's first task was to determine the value of ATV's music catalog. Earlier offers for ATV reportedly ranged from $39 million to $60 million. But after meetings with several advisors, Branca suggested an amount to Michael of $46 million. Branca said, "Catalogs usually bring 5 to 7 times the annual net publisher's share. We knew someone had bid $39 million, and we wanted to be above the crowd." On November the 20th, 1984, Michael communicated the $46 million bid to ATV's owner, Robert Holmes, a court, and at the same time requested a meeting. Holmes A. Court was a South African-born Australian entrepreneur and Australia's first billionaire. Holmes A. Court was one of the world's most feared corporate raiders through the 1980s, having built his empire single-handedly from virtually nothing to a diversified set of holdings and a media group with an estimated valuation of $2 billion Australian dollars. In a 1982 boardroom coup, his company acquired Lord Lou Grade's UK-based Associated Communications Corporation, ACC, which as part of the portfolio included the entire ATV music catalog and publishing interests. Holmes A. Court acknowledged receipt of Michael's $46 million offer and scheduled a meeting in London for December 14, 1984. In a four-month process, a team of 20 people began to go through ATV's books, checking the authenticity of every single significant composition in the nearly 4,000 song catalog. Jackson's legal team continued to meet in London with ATV representatives, and they began sketching up contracts in January 1985. The parties went through 8 drafts of the contract, but by April, it was time for Branca and Holmes A. Court to finally meet face-to-face. In agreement at last? Not quite. Some issues that the Jackson team thought had been resolved were raised once again. One demand, which Holmes A. Court apparently made of all bidders, was that the Australian billionaire would be allowed to keep a few ATV songs as gifts to relatives or friends. A condition that was completely unacceptable, said the Jackson team. By May 1985, negotiations became so snarled with Holmes A. Court that Jackson's representatives walked away from talks and refused to even answer calls for nearly a month. This, despite the fact that they had already invested more than $1 million in the potential acquisition. The deal was in jeopardy. Branca and Jackson told Holmes A. Court that he had to either accept their last offer or the whole deal was off. Holmes A. Court's response? Open the door to other bidders. Panicked, Jackson agreed to up his offer by $1.5 million. Holmes A. Court finally accepted it, even though a rival bidder had come up with a higher bid. However, it appeared that the singer could close the deal more quickly. A Holmes A. Court representative said at the time, quote, "In the end, it came down to who could act fastest, and Mr. Jackson was in a position to act." When asked how Jackson would finance the ATV acquisition, one source close to the singer laughed and replied, "Out of his own pocket?" It was probably one of the simplest financing deals in history. The contract was finally signed on August 10, 1985. Although neither Jackson nor Holmes A. Court were present, the two instead scheduled to meet for the first time that October when Michael visited Australia as a guest of Holmes A. Court and appeared on the Channel 7 Perth telethon. The visit wasn't just a courtesy call, it was in the contract, a provision requested by Holmes A. Court, who owned the television station at the time. When the music deal was reported on by the press, many pop fans were surprised when Jackson demonstrated the ambition and resources to pull off such a complex business deal. But the people close to the pop star were not surprised. Frank DeLeo, Michael's personal manager, said he has long been impressed by Michael's, quote, sound business sense. A lot of artists don't know anything about business affairs, but Michael is involved in every facet of his career. He's not one of those people who stops thinking when he walks out of the recording studio or off the stage. Its impact. As soon as Michael made the purchase, he and his representatives investigated ways to make it pay off for him. He hired people to develop an anthology series and four films using the Beatles' music, including Strawberry Fields, an animated feature, Back in the USSR, a movie based on Russian rockers, and films based on Eleanor Rigby and The Fool on the Hill. Michael also planned to produce musical greeting cards and music boxes featuring several famous Beatles tracks. Knowing the enormous commercial value of identifiable pop classics would have to large corporations, Jackson, through ATV, also secured a licensing agreement for the first ever commercial use of the Beatles song, Help, allowing the Ford Motor Company to use it for its Lincoln Mercury advertising campaign at a reported cost of $100,000. But when in 1987, ATV attempted to license the song Revolution to Nike for a sneaker ad, Jackson was confronted with backlash in the press and also from Paul McCartney and John Lennon's widow, Yoko Ono. When asked what she thought of the Nike deal, Yoko Ono said, "John's song should not be part of a cult of glorified martyrdom. They should be enjoyed by kids today." A representative of Jackson later rebutted by saying, "Basically, Michael doesn't love doing advertising, but advertising is an art form these days, and it's a great way to expose wonderful old music to a new generation. My 15-year-old son hears music in TV commercials that he's never been exposed to before. In fact, that's the whole point. It's the responsibility of the publisher to make sure these songs don't die on the shelf." Apart from obvious financial gains to be had licensing the Beatles' music, Jackson also wanted to draw focus on some of his underappreciated musical idols by acting as executive producer for a film about the life story of Little Richard. Utilizing the Little Richard songs acquired in the sale, representatives saw no conflict between Jackson's squeaky clean image and that of Little Richard, who had publicly acknowledged his wild lifestyle, previous drug use, and bouts of homosexuality. Michael loves Little Richard's music. However, this film never materialized. Later dealings. The years following the Michael Jackson ATV acquisition proved to be incredibly profitable. By 1993, ATV had accumulated profits of over $150 million, with annual revenues of about $30 million. In 1995, Sony offered Jackson $110 million for a 50% stake in a combined ATV and Sony Music Publishing joint venture. Facing financial issues since being confronted with child abuse allegations in 1993, what followed was hurriedly arranged meetings and disagreements over the selling price. But a deal was signed by Jackson, who had essentially sold half ownership of the Beatles and other songs for a large profit, combining with Sony Music to create the third largest music publishing entity in the world, although publishing rights to Jackson's own songs were not included in the deal. As the years went by, Jackson continued to suffer from financial issues and legal troubles. In 2006, Sony gained operational control of Sony and ATV and obtained an option to buy Jackson's stake in the company at any time. But before he relinquished this control over the catalog, Jackson wanted to ensure certain publishing interests were in the right hands. Therefore, Jackson opted to gift Little Richard his publishing back. It's reported that he did so because he knew the struggles of black artists in Richard's time and felt he deserved it.
And Little Richard was so touched by that. He told us yesterday that it meant so much to him. Ultimately, they couldn't work out the deal, but he said it was not Michael's fault. It was working with the Sony side and some other pieces. But the gesture showed the humanitarian side of Michael Jackson.
In 2016, Sony acquired the Jackson estate's stake in Sony ATV in a deal valued at around $750 million. The Jackson estate retained a 10% holding in EMI Music Publishing, but in July 2018, Sony ATV bought out the Jackson estate for $287.5 million. Today, the Jackson estate still maintains ownership of MyJack Music, which holds the rights to Michael Jackson's songs and master recordings. Thanks for watching. Watch more videos on the personal life and career of the King of Pop, and check out our online store for our original MJ-inspired styles.